REGGAE uprising with your host Daniella.
Greetings and welcome to another episode of REGGAE uprising podcast, connecting people of the African diaspora through wisdom, overstanding, and inspirational stories, all backed by a soundtrack of sweet reggae music. Now, if you're new to the podcast, we have a new episode every single Wednesday where I feature a new guest who picks seven reggae selection, like I said, as the soundtrack to the interview and their story. Also, if you are a newcomer to this podcast, you've missed out on plenty of real good episodes. So all you need to do to get caught up on those, as well as check out my music, as I'm also a reggae singer-songwriter, is go to daniella.co.uk. Now, all of my regular listeners, welcome. Thank you for coming back and checking in with me. I really appreciate all of your support and love. And I hope you enjoyed last week's episode. If you or someone you know would like to feature in a future episode, all you need to do again is just go to my website, daniella.co.uk, and I will also leave that link in the description for you. Right, it's about time we got started. This week's guest first selection is Bob Marley's Stir It Up. As well as an MBA and Masters, this week's guest is owner of She's the Boss International, senior business advisor with Enterprise Europe Network, multi-award winning strategy and innovation expert, entrepreneur, university lecturer, charity trustee, radio presenter, and also finds the time to host her own weekly podcast series titled Female Entrepreneur Stories. I would like to welcome Daniella Genus. Greetings and welcome, Daniella.
Oh, what a wonderful intro. I love the energy. Thank you so much for having me.
You're more than welcome. You're more than welcome. Can you tell us the reason for that first selection we just heard?
So that song, I'm a huge Bob Marley fan, first and foremostly. And it was so difficult trying to pick out of all of his back catalogue the song that means the most to me. But that song really has a special place in my heart because it was one of the songs that I did one of my dances to at my wedding. So it's special because it reminds me of dancing for the first time with my husband. So we did like a mashup and that was one of the songs within it. We also had a wedding website and that song, in addition to Waiting in Vain, was playing on the website. So that was the reason for that selection. I just think it's such a beautiful song. Don't necessarily love the reason behind the song because I do believe he wrote it for another woman that wasn't his wife, but it's still to me a very beautiful song and it's very romantic.
Can you tell us more about this mashup? I'm intrigued. What was this mashup you did for your wedding?
Oh, well, so it included Capleton in our heart.
Okay.
In addition to Miguel Adorn, that's more of an R&B song, and we kind of blended them all in together and did a dance to the mashup. The In Our Heart part was my favourite. I'm a bashment queen at heart, so
okay.
That one gave me the opportunity to really dance it out.
Okay, wow, that sounds amazing. So moving on to your heritage, as I ask all of my guests, as we're people of the diaspora, can you tell us your heritage?
So I'm a British-born Jamaican of African ancestry. So born in the UK, raised as a Jamaican, recently actually traced my lineage by doing a DNA test to find that my ancestors originally came from Nigeria, Kenya, and Sierra Leone. So that was quite an amazing thing to be revealed to me earlier this year, but proudly, fiercely Jamaican, and very much, I suppose, been raised, steeped in the culture of Jamaica, even though I was raised in the UK.
So, you know, in finding that information out about, you know, where your ancestry is specifically in Africa, has it kind of intrigued you as to find out more about the culture in those specific places, maybe the foods or the different traditions or maybe the language?
Well, my husband is actually Nigerian.
Okay.
So it was such an emotional experience because all of the time I thought that I was Ghanaian, because you hear a lot that people from Jamaica originally descended from Ghana or Nigeria. For some reason, I felt a real affinity to Ghana, even though I married a Nigerian man. He was convinced that I was Nigerian. So seeing the results, it said I was 47.9% Nigerian, I think it was. It kind of felt like I'd brought my family lineage home, if that makes sense, because my daughter is now, her dad is obviously Nigerian. So it was really an emotional time, actually, considering that whoever it was of my ancestors that were kidnapped from Nigeria, if we believe in the fact that the ancestors are watching and they're witnessing what's going on, they would have got to see the fact that I have, as I said, kind of brought the family bloodline back to Nigeria, even though it's not the physical return, it's a spiritual stroke, like physical bloodline return. So I've definitely, just over the last years, I've been with my husband for 15 years, so I've definitely begun to understand a lot of things about the culture. I eat a lot of Nigerian food. I don't necessarily speak the language that my husband speaks fluently, which is Yoruba, but I understand a fair bit. But I definitely would like to explore a little more. And it was really interesting because the Kenyan aspects, I think it said I was 10% Kenyan, and I booked to go to Kenya. I don't know why, I just had this real affinity and yearning to go to Kenya. So I booked to go to Kenya in April of this year. Then obviously COVID happened, so I wasn't able to go. Found out in, I think it was August, about the fact that I had Kenyan heritage as well. So that felt really insane. And I definitely do still want to go to Kenya and explore that a little bit further. But in terms of Sierra Leone, I don't really know much about Sierra Leone, and I haven't really had the opportunity to investigate much further. But I would love to do an African ancestry test, which then tells you the specific tribes that you come from. But it was a really interesting process because a lot of the Jamaican people that I spoke to said that they wouldn't want to know because they think it would disrupt how they felt about being Jamaican, which I thought was really interesting because for me, it's not made any difference. Like I still represent and feel very deeply connected to Jamaica. But obviously anybody that has any understanding of history knows that Black people don't originate from Jamaica. We were taken there. So I don't necessarily know if I just answered your question,
You did in a really beautiful way. Do you know why those people that you spoke to felt that it would disrupt? Isn't it all part of their history, their heritage? Why it wouldn't make them any less Jamaican because they're also African?
I don't know. It was weird because not everybody had that response. There was a lot of people that kept saying to me, how did you find out? I want to do this too. So there was a lot of that. But I suppose you more pay attention to the negative race, human nature. And yeah, nobody was able to really give me a definitive response or answer as to why. They just said that they feel like they know that they're Jamaican and anything else would disrupt that. Whereas for me, that doesn't really make any difference to me. I'm still Jamaican, but now I know where my people came from. And as I said, the fact that I've now married a Nigerian and I'm clearly my ancestors were from Nigeria, I think it's a beautiful thing. And I really look forward to going to Nigeria. And I think what's going to be amazing is that it will be the first time that anybody from my lineage has been to Nigeria. So literally, I will be bringing back, I will be the first of my ancestors' lineage to step foot in the country of where we came from. And I think that is going to be a really emotional thing. And still being there, I'm still going to be proudly Jamaican, but I have to acknowledge that there was something before that, and that is clearly Africa. Africa is calling.
What a beautiful story. Oh my gosh. And the intuition of your husband is amazing. Absolutely amazing.
He was so excited. He said, my African queen, I brought you home. He said, I knew it. It was funny. One of my Ghanaian friends was so upset. She's like, I was convinced. I was telling my mum, I know she's one of us. She has to be one of us. And yeah, there was nothing named Ghana on that list.
Oh, wow. I want to move, I want to go back a little bit now. I want to go to you growing up, so your childhood. Who and what were your biggest influences growing up? I know you said Jamaican, you know, your Jamaican heritage was part of, you know, your upbringing, the culture in your house. But who and what, apart from that, influenced you?
Oh, so many things. So my grandfather, who was born in Trelawney in Jamaica, had a very deep and profound impact on me. I spent a lot of time with him growing up. He used to babysit us. So I'd spend a lot of time at his house, and he really instilled so many important things into my psyche. So the importance of working hard, of being resilient. So one of the lines he always used to say is, there's no room in this world for softies, because he recognised that I was quite sensitive. And he always kind of said he recognises that there's greatness in me, and in order for me to fulfil that, I can't be soft and sensitive. He always used to call me his busy bee, which not much has changed at all. But he had, I would say, probably one of the biggest impacts on my life, and in terms of how I... what I strive for and the way that I try to live my life. And also with my connection with Jamaica, he was very instrumental in I suppose, making sure that I had an understanding of where he came from and where that meant I came from. My parents, obviously, the same. My dad was born in the UK, I believe, but then went back to Jamaica, like, pretty much straight away, and stayed in Jamaica until his teenage years. And he was I don't know what you'd call it, sound man. So he had a sound back in the day. So growing up, music was very, very much a staple part of my life. And reggae music and what we'd call reggae at that time was a big deal in our household. And I've always been very much driven by music. I love music. It's very rare that you come into my house and I'm not playing music, and I do believe that came in part from my dad, but also my mom. My mom on a Sunday would have the reggae music playing pretty much all day while cooking, and both of them were very much about education, entrepreneurship. Especially my dad was always saying to me and drilling into me to make sure that I didn't work for the man, that I worked for myself. And my mum was always about, you need to go to university, you need to get your qualifications. And that, even though it probably didn't seem at the time that I was listening to what they were saying, I have pretty much followed the exact path that they told me to. Maybe not necessarily in the way that they expected it to pan out, but I can only assume that on some level, whilst I was outwardly appearing to rebel and saying, I don't want to go to uni and I don't want to do this, clearly penetrated because I went to uni and I started my own businesses. Outside of the family sphere, there was quite a few people. So a friend of mine, her dad, Lyndon Gibson, I speak about him quite a lot because he had a really big impact on me. He, when I was 16, he gave me a job at his business that he worked in, Build Mentor Program. And I was doing kind of mentor coordination, event management, and he kind of gave me my first step into event management. So my first business was actually an event management company, but I kind of got my training working with him. In addition to that, as I said before, I was quite sensitive, I was quite shy, very retiring, didn't really speak up much, but he really worked to bring that out of me. And he would sign me up for speaking engagements and not tell me, and take me to events and then call me on the stage to speak. And at the time, I hated him for it because I didn't feel like I could do it. But what that did is teach me how to do public speaking, which has really served me in great stead throughout the course of my career. So he had a great impact. Somebody else, Dennis Davis, did a program at my school, which was, I think it was called Emoja. It was like a black confidence program for young black kids. And he really, again, taught me how to be confident, to really believe that I was from greatness and that I could be great. So he had a really big impact on me and how I viewed myself as a black girl in a place where there wasn't that many black people. So I wasn't necessarily in a city that was void of black people. So there's black people in Nottingham, but it wasn't as multicultural as Birmingham. And he really helped me to, I suppose, see the difference for the beauty that it was, as opposed to it being like I'm black and I'm different and this is awkward. And teaching me about my history and where like, well, not even where I came from, but the great people in history that looked like me. And I think that had a big impact on me also. So when I think about it, a lot of the great influences in my life have been male, more than anything, which I don't think I'd ever really thought about until you've just asked me that question.
Well, it sounds like you knew exactly who those people were. There wasn't any hesitation. It came straight to mind exactly who they were. So subconsciously, it's there, obviously.
Yeah, for sure.
We're going to move on to your next selection, which is Beres Hammond, What One Dance Can Do. Why did you pick this selection?
Well, you can't have any reggae playlist without some Beres in it. I love Beres. He's such a phenomenal artist. I've seen him live and he's got so much energy. Beres Hammond is pretty much the soundtrack of my childhood, whether it be christenings, whether it be Sundays, my mum swinging the chicken. Beres Hammond was always there, and that song in particular, I loved the trio of songs because it was this one, then it was the response song, the female response song, I can't remember the name of the lady that sang it, and then the He Loves Me Now, She Loves Me Now, sorry, at the end of the trilogy of song. And I just loved the fact that it was like a story through the three songs, and this was the first one in that lineup, so I love this song.
Here we go with Beres Hammond, What One Dance Can Do.
And I can tell you a story about what one dance can do. What one dance can do. One dance can do. One dance can do. And listen now. After one dance on the floor, she came back wanting for more. Now I don't know what it is that I've got. But she whispered, it was so nice, so nice.
Pinpoint where you first showed your entrepreneurial skills?
Yes. At school, I taught myself how to braid hair, and I started charging my friends to braid their hair. Ideally, or initially, on lunch breaks, but then it kind of spilt through into the classrooms. And I remember getting into a lot of trouble, particularly in my maths class, for braiding people's hair in the back of the class. I don't think I was getting paid much money for it, probably £2 here or there, but I'd say that's the first kind of example when I look back of me trying to hustle and make some money on the side. I also remember negotiating with my dad to pay me because I didn't ever get pocket money. I remember negotiating with him to pay me to clean his car instead of going to the car wash and paying those people. So I was always on like a mission to try and raise some funds through whatever means I could. But they're probably the two earliest memories that I have of me doing that.
Okay. And can you tell us more about your journey from adolescence to adulthood?
That's a big question. So I alluded to the fact that I had worked with Build Mentor Program. So that was when I was still in Nottingham. Worked there until I was, I think, just before I left to come to university. So I left to come to uni just a week before my 19th birthday and came to Birmingham. And I'd originally wanted to go to performing arts school. I was really like adamant I wasn't going to university. I wanted to go to performing arts school so that I could become a singer, dancer, writer. But then realised actually I didn't necessarily have the confidence for that. My voice wasn't particularly powerful. I can hold a note, but I'm not like the best singer. And therefore decided to take a different route. Also wanted to be like a media mogul. And I really loved the whole Oprah Winfrey with her show, with her network, with her magazine, and decided that I wanted to be the UK version of Oprah. So I came to university to study media and communications, specialising in television production. And whilst at university, I founded the African Caribbean Society and started to organise events that pretty much enabled me to keep my toe in the whole performing arts realm. So we did something called talent and organized talent competitions between the universities in Birmingham firstly, and then across the Midlands, and then nationally. And I realized I was really good at event management. So I'd done a bit of event management when I'd been working for Build, but I really was able to really get some proper experience whilst doing it as the president of the African Caribbean Society. And I was the president, I'm sure, for like the whole of university. Nobody dared to vote me out. But yeah, found that I was really good at it. Managed to get sponsorship from lots of major brands, including HMV, Alizé. I don't know if anybody remembers Alizé, but I got Alizé to sponsor one of our events, and they sent us like crate loads of Alizé. So I was a big hit with my housemates at the time.
He was everybody's best friend.
Yeah, everyone was getting the Alizé because they sent like crates upon crates. I always remember it because I was drinking Alizé for months. but yeah, found, and people really enjoyed the events that we did, and there was great fun. I was really enjoyed university, and then finished uni and was like, now what? Went from job to job. The idea had been to be this kind of Oprah media mogul, and lots of the people were saying, look, if you want to get into the media, you're going to have to move to London. And I just didn't want to do that. For a variety of reasons, but the main reason being that I'm from a small city, so moving to Birmingham to a bigger city was a big enough of a deal, but the concept of them moving to London was just too much. So I said, no, I'm going to stay here and see what I can work out, and realised I hated working. So I went from job to job, stayed in the job for the longest of 3 months at a time, and then I'd quit. And then probably 11 of the 12 months post uni, I decided that I was going to start a business, and found out about a program that was being run by my university that provided business startup support, and joined that program. And one of my friends from university was also on the program. She wanted to do an event management company. I actually wanted to create a performing arts school. Like a media school. So in the vision was that it would be a building, there'd be an event space, we'd have a radio station, we'd have a magazine, we'd have a YouTube channel. So I actually went on the program with that in mind. And then we joined forces and started our company, Aspire For You. And the idea behind Aspire For You is we do all of that performance-based stuff, but we'd also do event management. So we kind of merged our two ideas. And then we invited two other friends from university who also had an interest in business, in events, in performing arts to start the business with us. So we did that. And within, I think it was probably within a year, the three other girls went had gone their own separate ways. We had some falling out. Some people just had different views on what should be done versus what shouldn't be done. And then I was left with the business on my own. And kind of at that point, we hadn't really made much money. We'd been all over the place with what we were doing, and I decided I wanted to refine it. I really had a passion for supporting young people. So I registered officially as a community interest company in 2009. So we'd started in 2007. I registered as a CIC in 2009, and the aim was to provide opportunities for young people from disadvantaged backgrounds in the performing arts, media, and event management. So training, showcasing opportunities, development opportunities, and we were doing events. Now, between 2009 and 2011, I was able to secure funding, grew the team to 8 members of staff, was really doing exciting things, organizing lots of events, but realized that actually our income was heavily funded and we needed to kind of make it more commercial funded. So I changed the business model slightly to be a commercial event management company that specialized in celebration events and then providing the training. We'd use that money to provide the training for the young people who then would perform and organize those events for us. And I started winning awards, was being featured in the media, I was doing lots of speaking engagements, and then the funding stream started to finish. And I wasn't able to like address that balance of getting a commercial income and in fact, making sure that commercial income was more than the funded income. We were so heavily funded that it was impossible really to address the balance. And I went on a couple of programs, most namely being Goldman Sachs 10,000 Small Business Program, and then Unlimited Big Venture Challenge, to then get investment to help me bring in some specialized sales staff. During this time, we'd gone from 8 members of staff to 2, and a whole range of other kind of dramas happened in between this. And then I was able to secure the investment, and was thinking, great, everything is sorted, everything is fine. And I'm due to go and sign the paperwork for the investment, and the investors called and said, actually, we're not comfortable going ahead right now, but come back in 6 months. We're gonna hold this offer if you hit these sales targets. At the point that this was happening, I was heavily pregnant. My mum was in intensive care in Nottingham. She had taken seriously ill. So I was up and down the motorway, and I knew I wasn't going to be able to hit those sales targets. So I actually made the decision to close the business, but somebody reached out and said they wanted to buy it. So I sold it, not for anywhere near the amount that I believe now in retrospect that I should have sold it. But at the time, I just needed some money, and I knew that I wasn't going to be able to keep it open. So I took the deal and essentially went into a period of limbo. So there was a lot of learning over that time, over that period, a lot of development. I made a lot of mistakes, but I also had a lot of successes. And it's weird. It was like the best of times and the worst of times, that kind of shift from being at uni to being a businesswoman to then selling a business. And then I sold the business in August. My daughter had been born in July. And then I started my MBA in September, because the idea of just selling the business and sitting at home and being a mom just didn't really work for me. No disrespect to anybody that does work for, but I'd been so used to just doing 10,000 things at once. The concept of just sitting at home, I was like, I can't do that. So let me study. And then I did my MBA. And it was insane, because I'd actually done my master's in enterprise when I'd first started Aspire for You. And I'd got a commendation. And for my media communications, my undergrad, I got a 2.1, which is essentially a commendation as well. But for my MBA that I did with a brand new baby, I got a distinction. So that really was a really high point, and continues to be a really high point in my adult journey, because I was able to kind of best myself by kind of setting the goal and sticking to it. During a period where I was kind of going through grief, I was going through the grief of losing the business. I was also dealing with the fallout of my mom's illness. And yeah, it was again a very interesting time, and that pretty much leads us up to now. So after, whilst doing the MBA, I started Choose the Boss, which was initially called Genus Enterprise Consultants. And I also then got the contract with Enterprise Europe Network to be a senior business advisor. And the rest is history, really. That's what I've been doing since.
What an amazing story. Oh my gosh, oh my gosh, oh my gosh. So it's been, you know what I like as well? The fact that you told us, you know, the full spectrum of what you went through, rather than just saying, giving us just the high points, you gave us the low points. And because it's almost like when people telling their stories, they just tell the successes, and we don't get to, and then it can kind of make people that are kind of trying to go or trying to go on the same or a similar journey to you, get them disheartened in the fact that, oh no, this has failed. Oh no, this has failed. And because they don't see any other people's failures, they only see the successes. So that will have inspired a lot of people, I'm sure, that you, and the fact that you went through all of those things and you would just snap back into getting onto the next thing.
I don't know how, and I hope that I don't have to do that again, but I think it was the only way for my own mental health. I think had I just sold the business and just sat down, I really don't think that I would have been able to get back up again. And I know myself, and I know I needed to have something to do. And in doing that thing, then it put me in a position to be able to do other things. But I totally agree. A lot of people paint this rose-tinted view of this road to entrepreneurship, and it actually is something that really annoys me. And it's one of the reasons that I'm really open with my story. And I've kind of given some points, but there's many, many, many more, which includes somebody trying to sue me for £30,000, somebody else stealing one of my program ideas and getting funding for it after I'd paid them to try and commercialize it. So there was a lot of drama on the way, and I think I did kind of allude to that. And I'm quite open and honest with it, because I think it needs to be said, because sometimes people see people in certain positions and certain situations and feel like, okay, everything is perfect for them. But, and also it's that iceberg thing. So when you see that iceberg, you just see that little bit at the top. You don't see everything that's underneath the water. So people will see me now, and I'm quite confident in sharing like my expertise as a business consultant. And people could look and think, oh, well, she's got it all together. But there's been many times where I have not. And I'm more than happy to share and be honest about that, so people know.
Well, the two pivotal things that I take from your story, just me personally, is know yourself and also momentum. It seems like you kept the momentum going. No matter what was going on, the momentum, you kept that going, and that kind of is what, you know, spurred you forward, rather than, you know, stopping and focusing on the negative. You kept the momentum going, and that eventually evolved into something positive.
And I think what's also important is sometimes when you're going through these really difficult times, you think that this is it, like nothing can be worse than this, and this is the worst thing that could happen. But actually all of those bad things that happened to me has enabled me to now be in a position where I can guide and support other small business owners and entrepreneurs, because there's not many things that somebody can come to me and say, I've got a problem with this and I haven't been there and experienced it already. So I used to say, I wish I could have changed what happened, but actually what happened has enabled me to live the life that I'm living now. So even when you're in it, you need to stop and think, this is not pleasant, but what are the lessons that I'm learning, and how can I use these lessons in the future? How can this situation benefit me in the future?
Definitely. It's like a glass half full or half empty kind of thing going on there. But for now, I know you've got so much more to share, but I want to move on to your next selection, which is Garnet Silk, Mama Africa. Hello, Mama Africa. Why did you pick this one?
Oh, I love this song. Garnet Silk's just got the most beautiful voice. Again, I was really struggling to decide which song, but particularly given the story that I shared at the beginning, as much as I say I was raised as a proud Jamaican, my parents also instilled in me the importance of recognizing that we descend from Africa. And this was a song that my parents used to play. My dad in particular used to sing this song a lot, and it just brings back really fond memories of hearing my dad singing this and him explaining to us that we are all descended from Africa, and that the first person in this world was an African. And I just think this song really speaks to that beautifully.
All right, here we go with Garnet Silk, Mama Africa.
Am I coming home? Am I coming home? Hello, Mama Africa. How are you? I'm feeling fine, and I hope you're fine too. Hello, Mama Africa. How are you? I'm hoping you hear these words. Your grace turned blue. Grace turned blue. I'm saying I care, and I won't let go, even though we're oceans away. You're with me day by day. Memories of you keep flashing through my mind. The very thought of you
some of the other challenges that you had along the way. Could you share any of that with us?
Oh yeah, so there's many. So I kind of mentioned the fact that I've had quite a few staffing issues. Really, staffing was the main thing, and this is why I say now, building my business at the moment, I'm much happier, I'm more comfortable working with freelancers and outsourced contractors, because I don't know if it's because I'm a poor judge of character or what, but I had some real characters working for me with Aspire for You. So one of the ladies that was working for me as a project manager on one of the projects was just an absolute nightmare, screaming and shouting at staff. When I fired her, she took umbrage to that. And instead of just walking away, she decided that she wanted to take me to an employment tribunal for £29,999, to be precise. And it was so crazy because I, at the time, was maybe 26, 27. And she would have been like 50-something. And the idea that this woman had been in my organisation, seen some of our struggles and challenges, seeing the fact that we were helping all of these young people, and then she would try and turn around and sue us for just under 30 grand, absolutely blew my mind away. And I remember during that period just being full of rage, absolute rage. And I remember even more vividly speaking to my solicitor. I always remember I was in the car in front of my office, and the solicitor was saying, look, we don't want to go to the actual tribunal. We need to settle. And one of the key issues had been, before firing her, I had sought legal advice from a HR company. And they had given me the wrong advice. So whilst I had been within my rights to fire this person, I hadn't followed the right procedures, because I had fired her for two reasons. And I should have only fired her for one. But I didn't know. I'm not a HR specialist. That's why I paid the HR people. Once I'd gone back to the HR people, they said, well, you didn't pay for insurance for our advice, so therefore we can't help you. They never offered me this insurance, by the way. But then I managed to find this other legal team, and they helped me. But I always remember being in front of the office, in the car, and this guy telling me we're probably going to have to settle, and me punching the steering wheel because I was furious. I said, she's not getting any money. She cannot. And all I'm thinking about is, imagine all of these young people that are here that could do with some money, and we're going to be giving this woman money for not doing her job properly. So she didn't get anywhere near £30,000, like not anywhere near. But what they said is, I don't really to this day know why they did this, but the legal team said that they would put some money towards it if we matched. So they made their payment to her first, and then they told me to make the additional payment, and I just didn't. And that's just how it was left.
That's really unusual that a legal team would pay towards somebody. I don't think I've ever heard of that.
Yeah, it's weird. Now I'm thinking about it, it's dead weird. But the stress at the time, I remember I lost some of my hair, like probably the size of like a 50 pence piece in the middle of my head. And I've got a lot of hair, like I've got a big head. So this big, massive patch in the back of my head just fell out. And I put that down to the stress that I was under. But then what made it significantly worse, the person I then hired to replace this original project manager's job, who I informed and was very open with what had happened with her predecessor, she came in. I'm paying her to try and commercialize this project. So the project was funded, and I'm saying we need to make sure that there's legacy after it. So how do we commercialize it? Can you look at this? Can you look at that? Give her all these ideas. And I think it was probably 11 months in, she hadn't generated any income for the business at all, and said, oh, I've been given this once in a lifetime opportunity to do this business thing, so I'm going to go and do it. And then I found out afterwards from a few of my contacts who she'd approached that she'd basically taken my concept, so particularly the stuff that I'd been telling her to do to commercialize my project, and she'd turned it into her own business and had drawn down £100,000 of funding to go and deliver it herself. I then found stuff in her desk that showed that while she had been working for me, she'd actually been working on her own stuff. And that was, I'd say that was probably even more painful than the lady that tried to sue me, because of the fact that she had known that the lady before had tried to sue me. And she had come in and exploited us. So that kind of year and a half time period, and it was crazy because I was getting married at the same time. So I remember she quit probably like a week before my wedding. So it was a really difficult time. I remember a friend, like one of my really, really close friends, her parents were ill at the time, so I was worried about that. So there was just a lot going on. But the motto that I kind of live by now was born out of that, and it was, my motto is think big, take action, keep pushing. And the keep pushing part in particular refers pretty much to that period of time, because it was just so, like, dramatic. And there were times where I said, actually, this is too much, and these people are so exploitative. I remember I had to fire somebody else, or in fact, I got my friend to do it, fire somebody else because he was having an argument with his child's mother in the office and screaming and cursing at her. Somebody else I had to fire because they went missing for days, came in high as a kite. So there was just a lot of challenges. And the keep pushing element of my kind of mantra and motto for life comes from that. Like, I did keep pushing. And whilst the outcome in regards to the business specifically wasn't the one I had planned, the outcome for my life thus far demonstrates how important it is to keep pushing, because at that point I never would have dreamed that I'd be living the life that I'm living now in the way that I'm living it now. I'm not rich, I'm not famous, but my life is good.
So it was all worth it in the end. It was all worth it. It was worth it. It's worth it to, when you're on the edge, to you know, not give up and just to keep focused on and eyes on the prize.
Well, yeah, and also, as I said, making sure that you recognise the lessons in what's happening. At the time, I didn't, which is probably why my hair fell out and while I was punching steering wheels. But in retrospect, had those two things not happened to me, I wouldn't be able to teach people how to avoid those things happening to them. And therefore, people wouldn't necessarily be paying me what they're paying me now to tell them these things.
Woo! What a story. We're going to move on to your next selection, which is Bitty McLean, Walk Away From Love. Can you tell us why you chose this one?
I feel like I'm giving the same answer for all of them, because I love it. This song, there's just something really haunting about it. And I remember being at a christening, my cousin's christening, and it's dead weird now because my cousin's got three kids, which makes me feel super old because I remember his christening. And I remember this song coming on and like stopping in my tracks and saying, "Who? Like, what is this? This is a beautiful song." And I think for anybody that's ever been through any heartache of any sort, this is one of those songs that you listen to and cry to. I don't know if everybody does that, but as a teenager, I used to do that a lot. Like, oh my gosh, I'm so sad. Let me listen to a sad song and cry. So this song also represents kind of childhood angst and heartbreak for, you know, the crushes on the guys that lived down the street, etc. This song really reminds me of that. So it's a sad song and it makes me feel a bit sad, but also it makes me feel happy because it reminds me of a portion in my life, or a time in my life, where I was sad about stupid things that just really didn't matter. So it's kind of sad and funny at the same time.
Okay, here we go with Bitty McLean, Walk Away From Love.
It's not that I don't love you. You know how much I do. And it's not that I found somebody to take the place of you. It's just the feel within me when you touch my hand, and the fear that shakes my body, and I don't understand, so I'm
like you said earlier, you've had a lot of experience doing public speaking. What are your top three tips?
Number one is know your topic. If you know the topic that you're going to talk about, you really can't go wrong. And this is something I share with my clients. And particularly, there was one last year that was absolutely scared stiff of doing public speaking. And that was the thing I said to him, do you know what you're talking about? Do you know your topic area? Do you know your subject? And he said yes to all of them. Then you shouldn't have any problem speaking about it. And it was funny because not long after we did a public speaking training session, he had to go and deliver a presentation that he thought was going to be to the owner of a company. And when he arrived at the destination, the owner of the company had invited the whole team and put him on a stage with a big PowerPoint presentation. And he called me afterwards and said, Daniella, you're a demon, because how did you tell me, how did you say that I needed to be prepared for this? And I've walked into it. But he used the things that I said to him and was able to do it. And the first thing was, as long as you know your subject matter, be confident in that. The reason people fall down is because they don't know what they're talking about, or they try to speak about things that they don't have the information on to speak about confidently. You've obviously asked me questions. This is not public speaking in terms of a stage, but the principle remains. You've asked me questions about my life. I know my life. Therefore, there's no reason for me to be nervous about it. And the same applies if you ask me about stuff to do with my business or with kind of the business world. I'm not going to be nervous because I know what I'm talking about. So it's really about making sure that you've got a deep understanding of your subject area. The second, and I don't know if COVID is ever going to let us do in-person events again, but if you are doing a presentation or something, try not to rely too heavily on PowerPoint. Don't overload PowerPoint with loads of words. It's annoying. Nobody wants to see it. Use images with kind of high-level topic, not even topic, high-level bullet points or just titles to remind you of what you're talking about and as a guide, but don't write on the board exactly what you're going to say, because all that's going to happen is people are going to read what it says and ignore you. And this also applies to online events. I've been to a few online events and the person talking is just reading what's already on the screen. I'm not listening anymore because I'm just going to read it. So that's the other thing. And this is something that I'm still working on, but try to make sure that you're managing your speed and your pace, and that you're being really engaging. So asking questions, getting your audience, whoever it is that you're delivering to think of responses. So don't just be talking at people, try to involve people in it, and try not to speak so fast that people don't understand what you're saying. I speak quite fast, so I'm really making a conscious effort even now to slow down my pace so that people can follow what I'm saying. And sometimes, I don't know about you, but I've been in environments where people are speaking and they're going 100 miles per hour. I don't know what they've said. I don't understand what's going on. And it's just, they're talking at me. You need to involve people in whatever it is that you're talking about. something that I started to, or I had started to do before lockdown, when I was doing my speaking engagements, is getting the audience members to repeat my mantra after me. So you'll see on my social media every so often videos of me standing in front of an audience and them shouting, think big, take action, keep pushing. And it's that actually started, not necessarily just to get the audience participation, but to help calm my nerves. Because as much as I've been doing public speaking since I was like 17, I still do get nervous. And I think that's something that's probably always going to be there. But having the, like, starting with audience participation gives me time to calm down and to kind of get into the flow of it, without sounding like I'm racing to the end at 100 miles per hour. So I'd say they're the top. I could give you more than three, but they're my top tips.
Oh, that's some great advice there, which I will be taking on myself. Some great, great points there. I want to move on to your next selection, which is Dennis Brown, Here I Come. Can you tell us the reason for this one?
This is just a reggae classic, isn't it? I just feel, again, you can't have any list of reggae songs and not have this song included in it. Dennis Brown is a reggae icon, and this song just, I feel like, depicts all that is great in reggae music.
Here we go with Dennis Brown, Here I Come.
Here I come with love and not hatred. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow I all the days of my life. Envy no one, no wish to be with no evil man. For there come the day when you'll be weaved by the feathers and leave a brood children. Oh yeah, leave a past the children. Yeah. My head is anointed and my cup runneth over. Yeah. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow I all the days of my life.
Tell us more about your podcast, Female Entrepreneur Stories.
So I actually started it as part of my MBA dissertation research. So my dissertation was on female entrepreneurship, and like, I did a business plan for a business that supported female entrepreneurs. And in order to create that business plan, I had to do research to demonstrate what the challenges, the problems, the obstacles that were facing female entrepreneurs. And part of that, one part of it was to do a survey, questionnaires and focus group. But another part was to do one-to-one interviews. And actually, the first one-to-one interview that I did, as soon as I kind of started it, I realized this is quite powerful. And it was with a young lady called Imani Clough. And she was quite young and just really doing amazing things. And even though the interview was initially just to kind of get her understanding of what business issues she was facing for my dissertation, because the interview I felt was so good and so kind of informational, so inspiring, so motivational, so empowering, I asked her if she'd mind me sharing it on YouTube, because I'd recorded it anyway, and she said fine. And then each subsequent person that I interviewed, I asked them the same thing. So even once I'd finished my dissertation, I realized I was really enjoying doing these interviews, and I was really providing a voice for female entrepreneurs that wouldn't necessarily always get an opportunity to speak publicly. You often hear the stories of the Richard Bransons and the Alan Sugars, but we don't hear about the Imanis that live in some part of Birmingham that are running their business at 22. We don't get to hear about the there's another girl, Sasha Ferran, that I interviewed. And again, a really young girl, but out here doing stuff in the business world. And also, I feel like it's so important. I think role models are so important. And one of the key things that I committed to doing is making sure that I was interviewing women from a cross-section of backgrounds. So different ages, different races, different cultures, different religion, different stage of business, different types of businesses. And I quickly realized that there was definitely value in doing that. And it's continued. So that was, I started in 2017. I'm currently on interview 84, is being released like imminently. And yeah, I've really just enjoyed it. Initially, I was kind of inconsistent with it, but particularly over the last year, I've really pushed for consistency. And I'm seeing that it's really making an impact on the people that are engaging with the interviews. And even I shared this week on my Instagram, somebody had messaged me a couple of weeks ago to say, during the lockdown, every Sunday, listening to my interviews, because I released them at 8 o'clock, was part of their self-care Sundays and like part of their well-being practice, and how I'd helped them get through the lockdown. And that really was just a beautiful revelation to hear that it was making such a big impact. And it's something that I definitely will be continuing. I've interviewed women from Canada, from Jamaica, from Bali. So just like all around the world, in addition to people from all over the UK. And as I said, there's been 80 odd interviews, and I've covered pretty much every type of woman in business that you could find. So it's a really, I think it's a really valuable and useful tool. And particularly, one of the questions I always ask at the end is three pieces of advice you'd give to an aspiring entrepreneur. And a couple of months ago, I collated all of the three pieces of advice that had been shared from probably about 30 odd interviews. And that in itself was just a really powerful resource, because you've got all of these different women saying all of their three pieces of advice. So I want to continue it. I want to grow the audience. But I think it's amazing personally, if I do say so myself.
And with that said, I'm going to leave the link in the description. So this Sunday, you can tune in and do a little bit of self-care for yourselves. But for now, we're going to move on to your next selection, which is Budger Banton, Living While I'm Living. Why did you pick this one?
Budger is such a controversial character. For those that know, he was recently released from prison. And it's been... It was a difficult choice, because we don't want to, what is the word? We don't want to celebrate wrongdoings, but we also have to recognize that Budger Banton is an icon. And different people have different views on whether he should have been in prison or he shouldn't have been. But he is a poet. He is a cultural commentator. And this song, for me, it just has such a powerful message. And so many of his songs have such powerful messages. I feel like it's a song that really means a lot to me because of the message within it.
Okay, here we go with Budger Banton, Living While I'm Living.
I'm a living while I'm living, to the Father I will pray. Only Him know how we get through every day. Only I give the price, I'm a leg we have to pay. While our leaders play, all I see, people are rip and a rob, all are grime. Thief never love, is a thief with long bag. No love for the people who are suffering bad. Another toll to the poor, may God help his soul. What is to stop the youth from getting out of control? Full up on education, yet no own a payroll. The clothes for me back have countless eyes old. Could go on and on, the fool has never been told. I'm a living while I'm living, to the Father I will pray. Only Him know how we get through every day. With only I give the price, I'm a leg we have to pay. While our leaders play, we say who can afford to run will run. But what about those who can't? They will have to stay. Opportunity, a scarce commodity.
I've really enjoyed our interview today. You told us so many great stories, and a lot of them have been really, really inspirational. What I want to know as the final question before we get into your final selection is, what can we expect from you? Because we're near the end of 2020 now. What can we expect from you in 2021? What are your plans?
World domination. A joke. No, so at the moment, I'm really planning to go real big in 2021. I've been doing a lot of the kind of foundational work for the the business this year, and next year you're going to really see the fruits of that labor. I've got my website launching pretty soon, and yeah, next year I'm trying to make kind of easily six figures. I want to be in the media, on the media. It's takeover time. I'm ready. I've put in the work. I think it's time to reap the rewards. I have a 3-year vision, and next year is the year to really start putting that, the kind of things in motion to start building a legacy, really, both financially and both from a perspective, a reputational perspective as well. Like, I'm good at what I do, and I think that we need to be confident in saying that. And I really want to impact so many more people, both female entrepreneurs and male entrepreneurs, and also the community. I really want to have a significant impact on continuing to grow many, many, many more businesses and helping more people from my community to grow their businesses to a level that they're able to employ other people from my community and really leave a legacy for their families as well. I believe in group economics, and I believe that I can have an instrumental role in facilitating that by supporting as many businesses from our community as possible. And that's what I plan to do moving forward, and try to, I suppose, do it on a bigger scale.
So if you'd like to connect with Daniella, make sure you check out all the links that I will leave in the description, the many different ways that you can connect with her. We're going to move on to your final selection now, which is Sizzler Dry Cry.
Oh, one of my faves. So this song, there's an actual story behind it. I remember being at a club in Leicester. I used to go on this club night called After Dark Coach Party. Well, the place was called After Dark. The party was called Coach Party. And I remember exactly the point when I heard this song, and everybody in the party started singing at the top of their voices. And I remember just being so young, carefree, happy, and just in love with music. And this is just such a banger. And it will always take me back to being like 19 years of age in the club in Leicester. So enjoy.
Thank you so much for sharing your time and your wisdom and your inspirational stories today. I really do appreciate it.
Thank you for having me. I've really enjoyed it.
You're more than welcome. Right. I hope you've enjoyed this week's episode, everyone. Make sure you come straight back here next Wednesday for a fresh new guest. Until then, I'm going to leave you with the sounds of Sizzler Dry Cry. As always, blessed love.
Tears, even my heart cries, but who cares? Whose fault? No one but myself. Things do happen, words can't explain. Beyond the human reasoning, joy meets with pain. People would spend time just for us to separate. They don't want to see us reach nowhere. Oh girl, and you know I care. Why does it have to be this way? Can't tell you go, can't tell you to stay. Oh, just one of those days. Just one of those days.